Thank you for the introduction. As you heard, I'm in the Tuveson Lab. We're located in the Quick Building, which is right next door. And I wanted to thank everybody for coming out today to see what we do here at Cold Spring Harbor Laboratory. In the Tuveson Lab, we're uniquely focused on studying pancreatic cancer. So that's what I'm going to talk to you about today. Now, one of the things that's come out of years of cancer research is an understanding that not all cancers are the same. So lung cancer is different than brain cancer, skin cancer is different than pancreatic cancer. And in the Tuveson Lab, we are interested in studying pancreatic cancer because among the various cancers, pancreatic cancer is a very, very lethal disease. So what I'm showing on the screen is the percentage of patients who are still alive 5 years after they've been diagnosed with pancreatic cancer. And what you can see is even in the best case, when a patient's tumor is still confined to the pancreas and is caught at an early stage, there's only about a 32% chance of survival 5 years past diagnosis. And if the cancer has spread at all, which is actually pretty common for pancreatic cancer to have spread before diagnosis, those statistics drop off. So this is a cancer where there is truly an urgent and an unmet clinical need for better ways to diagnose the cancer sooner and for more effective treatments. So not everybody is entirely familiar with the pancreas as an organ, so I just wanted to put a little bit up about what the pancreas does. So the pancreas is an organ that lies behind your stomach in your body, and it has two major functions. The first is that it releases hormones such as insulin that help to regulate blood sugar levels. So you might have heard about this because when problems arise in that system, people can develop diabetes. But the pancreas has another function, which is that it releases digestive enzymes that go into your small intestine and help you digest your food. The pancreas itself, it's actually a large system of ducts. So there are cells in the pancreas that make these digestive enzymes, and then the digestive enzymes flow into these ducts, and these ducts transport the digestive enzymes to the small intestine, the same way a system of ducts in your house might transport hot or cold air throughout your house to help heat or cool your house. And I just want you to keep that idea of ducts in mind when I tell you about pancreatic cancer. So as I mentioned, pancreatic cancer is a very aggressive cancer. And it, as the name implies, it's a cancer that originates in the pancreas. There are actually a few different kinds of pancreatic cancer, but by and large, when people talk about pancreatic cancer, what they're really usually talking about is a type of pancreatic cancer called pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma. Now that's a really long and a scary word, but what I wanted to underline is that that middle word in pancreatic ductal adenocarcinoma, you can see duct right in it. Because this is a cancer that arises when something goes wrong with those cells that are making up the ducts of the pancreas. And they start making more of themselves when they're not supposed to be and forming a tumor, and ultimately moving away from the duct system into places that they're not supposed to be. Now, pancreatic cancer is not the most common cancer. There are about 56,000 new cases in the United States each year. But as I mentioned, it's one of the most deadly cancers, which is why we're so interested in studying it. In addition, this is a cancer that tends to affect people over the age of 45. So in the Tuveson Lab, our research has two major goals. The first is that we're trying to find ways to be able to diagnose pancreatic cancer sooner, because we know that if we can catch tumors early, we have a much better chance of being able to treat them and to cure patients. And the second is that we're trying to develop treatments that are much more effective at being able to cure people with pancreatic cancer, because our current treatments just aren't good enough. So the way that we're doing this is that we have developed a technology called organoids. And to understand organoids, you first have to understand how most people traditionally study cancer in the lab. Traditionally, when scientists wanted to study cancer in the lab, they took patients' tumor cells and they cultured them flat on a tissue culture dish. However, I would make the argument that a tumor doesn't grow flat in the human body. A tumor is a three-dimensional thing that's growing in a person's body. And so to really be able to study cancer, we want to be able to study it in three dimensions. So with the organoid system, which I'm showing here on the right of the screen, what we do is we take a patient's cancer cells and we embed them in a substance that's called Matrigel. Now Matrigel is a little bit like gelatin in terms of its consistency, but inside of it, it has lots of different proteins and other factors that cancer cells interact with in the body. And when we embed the cancer cells inside of this gelatin-like substance, the cancer cells will kind of find each other and self-organize into these spheres that we call organoids. And then we can put on top of that a liquid medium that has food and other things that the cancer cells need to survive. And this is how we can study cancer. So we don't look at cancer cells like this every day, but what I'm showing here is an electron micrograph that was taken by Toby Lobaoni in the lab with the help of Cold Spring Harbor lab microscopist Stephen Hearn. So what you can see here are these big balls, or the organoids themselves. And within the organoids, you can actually see the outlines of individual cancer cells of the organoid. So this is what these organoids look like. So one of the exciting things about the organoid system that's a little bit different from other ways that people culture cells in the lab is that we can also culture healthy, normal pancreatic ductal cells using the same system. So side by side, we can compare these healthy, normal ductal cells to these ductal cancerous cells, and we can ask what makes the cancer cells different. And one of the ways that we're using that is to try and identify molecules that are uniquely produced by the cancer cells that might allow us to detect pancreatic cancer sooner. This is a project that Tobioni is leading in the lab now. And what he's doing is he's trying to develop tools that would allow us to detect pancreatic cancer. So here I'm showing an experiment that Toby's done with one of his very promising tools. This is a reagent called an antibody. And what this tool does is it sticks down to whatever it recognizes. And in this case, Toby has developed an antibody that's recognizing pancreatic cancer cells. So what he has are tissue sections on a microscope slide. They've been stained with blue to show where the DNA of the individual cells in the tissue are. And then he's allowed his antibody to stick down to anything that it recognizes on that tissue. Now on the left is a normal, healthy pancreas tissue, and on the right is a pancreatic cancer tissue. And what you can see is on the left, where that normal tissue is, there's no brown coloring. Brown coloring here shows you anywhere where that antibody stuck down, where it saw something, where it recognized something, where it stuck to something. Now on the pancreatic cancer tissue, you can see it's all lit up with brown coloring, showing that Toby's antibody very specifically is recognizing something about pancreatic cancer cells. And now we're hoping to develop tools like this antibody that Toby has developed, potentially into some kind of early diagnostic test, hopefully to be able to diagnose the cancer sooner. In addition, we're trying to understand what makes pancreatic tumors different. And one of the things that we know from our research that makes pancreatic tumors different is that surprisingly, when you look at a pancreatic tumor, the cancer cells actually make up a small percentage of the cells in the tumor. In fact, what the cancer cells do is they're very good at recruiting and co-opting other cells in the body to come into the tumor and help them. So we call these other cells that the pancreatic cancer cells have recruited stromal cells. And this is a very active area of research in the lab to understand who are these cells that are being recruited? What do they do when they get recruited into the tumor, and how are they helping the tumor? Because if we understand how these non-cancerous cells are helping the cancer cells, we could potentially develop new medicines that could block that. This is work that's being led in part by Jen Thalapilli, who I'm showing here in the picture. And we're actually using our organoid system to do this. So one of the things that we can do is we can take those stromal cells, in this case it's a kind of stromal cell that are called fibroblasts, and we can embed them in Matrigel along with the cancer cells. Now here the cancer cells, which are colored in purple, will again self-organize into these cancer organoids. But the stromal cells, these fibroblasts, will do their own rearranging and start to make contact directly with the cancer cells. So you can see these blue fibroblasts in the image are reaching out. They're making projections, and they're actually touching the cancer cells. And so now work in the lab is going towards trying to understand what is the signaling that's going on between these two different cell types that allows this to happen, and how can we stop that? The other thing that we're doing in the lab is we're developing patient-derived organoids as a platform for personalized medicine. So when a patient goes into the clinic and has a tumor removed by surgery or has a biopsy of a tumor that can't be removed by surgery, that patient can elect to send us his or her tumor tissue, and we take that tissue and we can make a human organoid culture from a person's cancer. We're doing all kinds of things with these human organoid cultures. We're trying to use them to better understand human cancer. We're trying to use them to better understand new medicines that could help patients that haven't even been tested in the clinic yet. And we're also using them for large-scale drug screening. So this project was initially led by Hervé Thiriac in the lab, and it's now being led by Dennis and Hardik, who are shown in the picture on the left. And one of the things that we do with the organoids is we have these special culture plates, which is this white thing that's shown in the picture on the right. And I don't know if you can quite make it out, but if you can see it, this white plate actually has 96 distinct holes in it. So we can culture organoids in each of those 96 distinct holes, and then we can administer a different drug or a different medicine to each hole and ask which drugs killed this patient's tumor cells and which drugs didn't. And in fact, the way that we do this is we use a device that's manufactured by Hewlett-Packard. You may be familiar with Hewlett-Packard because they make inkjet printers. And it turns out the technology that's needed to precisely administer exact volumes of ink in an exact location on a piece of paper can be repurposed for us to precisely administer exact volumes of different medicines into this 96-well plate. And this really speeds up our work because we can load this plate in, and just like an inkjet printer at your house would print off a piece of paper in a couple of minutes, in literally a couple of minutes, we can administer 96 different medicines into this plate and test 96 different things at once. So ultimately, we are working to try and develop this into a clinical test. We hope someday a patient would go to their doctor, have a piece of their tumor sent to us, we would be able to make the organoids, test 96 different drugs, and send their doctor back a report that says, this patient is going to do really well on this medicine, but I would never give them this medicine because it's not going to help them. So that's what we're working on right now, is trying to really develop that into a clinical test. So with that, I want to thank all of the members of the Tuveson Laboratory. We're a rather large group of people who are all very dedicated to the study of pancreatic cancer. In addition, I wanted to mention, as you heard at the beginning, we're actually located one building over. We actually have a setup in the lobby, so if you want to come in and see that 96-well plate I was talking about, or some of the other work that we're doing, feel free to come on over to the lobby of the next building over and see what we're doing. Thank you.